A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood is an absolutely wonderful film about a cynical writer and his interactions with everyone's favorite neighbor and TV father figure, Fred Rogers. The film stars Matthew Rhys as the cynical journalist and Tom Hanks as Fred Rogers. It's a wonderful film. Anyone who ever grew up watching or has ever seen any of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood will find this film to be very heartfelt, beautifully shot, beautifully edited, and beautifully acted, and altogether just an amazing film. It's not your standard biographical film about Fred Rogers. What it is really is it's a film about Matthew Rhys's character, who is an award-winning journalist who starts off the film with a fist fight at his sister's wedding with his father over the fact that his father abandoned him and his sister and his mother when his mother was dying with cancer. He gets a busted up nose, and then his editor says, "You're too cynical. I'm going to give you a little puff piece. You need to go out and look into it. It's 400 words on Fred Rogers. You can do it. Just do it for this issue we're doing about heroes." He kind of scoffs at the deal. "You want me to write about Mr. Rogers? It's Mr. Rogers. What's there to know about Mr. Rogers?" Because he thinks Mr. Rogers is full of shit. And so he's like, "Okay, I'll go do it." Well, he goes off to meet Mr. Rogers at his studio where they're filming an episode. And he starts to kind of observe Mr. Rogers from a different perspective, in that he's seeing him and he doesn't fully believe that Mr. Rogers is as genuine as he is. He sees him as maybe playing an act or having this mask that he wears throughout this first interaction with the interview. And Mr. Rogers ends up kind of pulling away his mask and gets him to talk about his relationship with his father. He still thinks that Mr. Rogers is bullshitting him in a little bit of a way and not really being honest or as wholesome as he's portrayed on TV. So he goes back off to his home, finds out that his father's new girlfriend, well, he's had for several years, but never introduced him to his son or his daughter at this point, is talking with his wife. And he gets really mad, yells and berates his father, who's played pretty good by Chris Cooper, and it ends up causing his father to have a heart attack. He falls out on the floor. His wife kind of yells at him a little bit and is like, "Why are you doing this to your father?" They go to the hospital where he just doesn't want to be there. He's like, I hate this man. This man abandoned me. He left me. I don't want to deal with this man. Why is he coming back here? He wants something out of life." And then he has this heart attack. He probably doesn't even realize or believe that this heart attack is real. He thinks it's, you know, just an elaborate ruse by his father to maybe try to position himself back in, because his father tried to talk to him several times earlier and wasn't able to. Well, at the hospital, there's a bit of a confrontation between his wife, because he's been watching older episodes of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood and still can't quite figure out Fred Rogers, still kind of thinks he's BSing a little bit, but is not really sure about that anymore, because he's not seeing any cracks in the facade. He's seeing Mr. Rogers is truly this beautiful person inside and out who only cares about helping other people. Well, he's like, "I gotta go finish this article. It's my job. I don't even want to be here." And he just runs off and leaves his wife, his child, at the hospital with his dying father. Hops on a bus, goes to the studio in Pittsburgh where Mr. Rogers is, and he kind of stumbles in exhausted, and then boom, falls out right in the middle of the floor of the studio in the neighborhood, so to speak. And then he goes into his mind, in essence, where he's basically been transported into an episode of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, and he's like a little boy or a little puppet the size of King Friday the 13th and the other puppets, and he sees Mr. Rogers and his wife kind of towering over him, and he doesn't really figure it out just yet, but he kind of is mystified in a way, because he's into this world that kids would go into when they would watch Mr. Rogers, because Mr. Rogers was trying to help people. He was trying to help children understand the world. And then when he wakes up, he's at Mr. Rogers' house. Him and his wife had brought him there. And he has, you know, some conversation with him. And, you know, they talk about, a little bit earlier in the film, they talked about, did he have any childhood animals? Because Mr. Rogers is really trying to take the interview at his own pace. And he brings out his puppets and starts talking to him with his puppets. He kind of pisses off the guy a little bit before he runs off. But he does tell Mr. Rogers that he did have an older toy, an old stuffed rabbit that he called Old Rabbit. And Mr. Rogers is like, well, you need to think about what it is when you had that rabbit. Think about the memories and how you felt when you had it and how, you know, powerful you were able to feel within yourself because you felt like you meant something and how much you loved that little rabbit and how much you projected that you loved him. So after his little episode, he wakes back up in Mr. Rogers' house. They kind of have a little bit of a heart-to-heart, and he sees Mr. Rogers is still really just being the same character. He's projecting himself in the exact same way. And they have like a conversation about Mr. Rogers' sons and how one of his sons wouldn't tell people that he was the son of Mr. Rogers, and the other son always tried to test him and push his boundaries and such. But, you know, that he still let them learn and grow as children, and he loved them unconditionally as their father. So they go off to a restaurant, sit down, and there's this heartfelt moment where Mr. Rogers tells him, and he's like, I just want you to be quiet for a minute and think about everyone that's loved you into being. And there's this beautiful moment where it goes silent, and you hear people eating in the restaurant, and all of a sudden all of the sound slowly starts to die out. It's almost as if everyone's taking that moment of silence with them. But eventually the silence breaks, and then the reporter, he just breaks down into tears at this point because he does start to kind of release the anger that he had built up against his father, that hatred he had for him for abandoning him, and also the skepticism he had towards people and their morality or how they portray themselves, specifically in this case, Mr. Rogers. At this point, he's not seeing Mr. Rogers as potential fraud. He's seeing Mr. Rogers as this true, beautiful, honest man who is just trying to help people, trying to help children grow and love. And it's a very poignant moment in the film, and it really works, absolutely. And there's just beautiful acting by both Tom Hanks and Matthew Rhys in this instance. And from there, he then goes back and sees his father at his house, where his father's basically in like a hospital bed, and he's been given an expiration date. He is dying. It will be a short amount of time. And, you know, him and his father, they finally are able to reconcile each other's differences and try to grow. He prompts his father, I'm going to be a good father for my son. And he shows his father the article that he wrote for Mr. Rogers, which his Esquire, I believe, is a magazine. The editor ended up loving it and said, you're going to be on the front cover. So he wrote like a 10,000-word article on Mr. Rogers instead of the 400-word puff piece that was originally wanted. Mr. Rogers reads the article. He calls him up, and then he says, I'm coming to visit you. Is that okay? So he comes and visits him at his father's house. They sit down and they have a talk, and there's a moment where Mr. Rogers walks in the door, and it's very beautiful because everybody's like wide-eyed and bushy-tailed looking at it. And then his sister's, the writer's sister's husband is like, it's Mr. Frickin' Rogers. Oh my God, he's in my house. And everybody is just really enjoying the moment. And they kind of sit there and bond and have a couple little moments where they either pray or just kind of meditate in a sense about things. And before Mr. Rogers leaves, he goes to Chris Cooper's character and whispers something into his ear. And the writer, of course, kind of wants to know what it is. But the dad kind of smiles and laughs and is like, thank you, Mr. Rogers, thank you. And they walk out. And then the writer follows Mr. Rogers out. And then he's like, well, what did you say? And he's like, I asked him to pray for me. And he's like, well, why did you do that? And then Mr. Rogers says that, you know, I figured that anybody that's going to be seeing God that soon and is about to be that close to him, you know, he'll hear his prayers even more. And that's what I need. And it was a very sad, touching moment. And then the film ends with Mr. Rogers finishing up shooting an episode of Beautiful Day, Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. And he walks over to the piano and just starts playing the piano. As the image kind of fades away or moves around the set, as all the different lights start to go off, Mr. Rogers is still just playing the piano. It is an absolutely beautiful film. I would highly recommend it. It is one of those ones that, because of the subject matter, it's not something that was very highly marketed or highly publicized, but it is a wonderful film. It's very beautiful in everything from the set recreation of, you know, Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, the costumes that they wear, the hair and the makeup. You know, Tom Hanks is a little bit more husky than Mr. Rogers, but you really feel that this is Mr. Rogers. Certainly, if you ever watch Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, then you can have this connection with this film, and it is very good. I would highly recommend it. And other than that, thank you, and feel free to like, subscribe, and share. Please have a good day.